if you're running a Next.js application or any other React application that uses React server components in production, you want to patch it because we got new vulnerabilities. And it's barely been 2 weeks since we got the first vulnerability. So yeah, we got to talk about it. So in case you missed it, which is bad if you're running a Next.js application or any other React server component application in production, but if you missed it, there has been a huge exploit, a huge vulnerability related to React server components and server actions. And you really need to patch your production application. You need to make sure that your dependencies, specifically Next.js or whichever framework you're using, are up to date so that you're secure. Because this was a big one. In case you missed it, this vulnerability, which was published on December the 3rd by the React team, allowed attackers to execute malicious code on your server. Yes, that is what was possible. Now, there is a very detailed and good write-up about this vulnerability, which I'll link below. I'll not go through it in detail, but in the end, to give you a brief idea of how this vulnerability worked or how this attack worked, the problem with React server components and server actions is that it's not a traditional API model where you have an endpoint on the server and you send requests to it from the client, and on the endpoint you validate those requests and you have a clear data structure that you're expecting to get and you're just exchanging JSON data. Instead, with React server components and server actions, the protocol is a bit more complex. Yeah, of course, you're still sending JSON data across the wire in the end, but this is not just raw data like some user data that should be stored in the database and that is validated first and any unexpected properties are ignored, but instead, it is data that can capture application state and instructions on which server actions to execute on the server, for example. And the way this is being parsed or was parsed opened up a big vulnerability. In the end, the attack worked by sending this here as a payload to a Next.js application, for example, if it wasn't patched, that used React server components, because this would be parsed by React in the end on the server by the package that's responsible for translating that received data into work that is to be done on the server. And what this here means in the end is that we got two chunks in that payload that are being sent to the server in this attack here, and React or that package will parse that. And these dollar sign instructions here, these are special. $1 simply tells the parser to, in the end, look at this second chunk in the payload. And this $@ thing tells the parser to use whatever chunk is referenced here. So the first chunk, chunk zero, should be treated as a raw chunk. So that in the end created a loop where the first chunk pointed at the second chunk, which pointed back at the first chunk, and it kept on going up a chain of instructions here in the end, where it looked at the then property in that second chunk, which pointed back at the first chunk, where the then property referred back to the then property of the second chunk, that then referred back. And in the end, what happened is that we got a pointer to the constructor of the then method, which is the function constructor, which exists in JavaScript. And to make this a bit less theoretical, in JavaScript, also in the browser, you can use the function constructor to create a function. How does it work? Well, you pass your function body as a string to it. So if I pass console log hi here as a string, and I then execute this, I got a function definition with that console log hi code inside of it. Now, if I execute this definition here, therefore, I execute that code and I see hi in my console. And that's in the end how this exploit worked. By pointing at the constructor here, the attackers were able to define any code they wanted to be executed. For example, this code here. Now, how exactly does it get executed? And why is it in this weird prefix thing here? Well, that package will try to parse foreign data and it will call a get method in the end, which in the end is this code, which was that loop that in the end led to the constructor. So it calls this with the get method, and it passes this prefix to whatever function this instruction in the end refers to. So this was the function body that ended up in that function constructor, and it then executed that for us because that is one part of what React server components and server actions do. They allow you to, or implicitly you to, send an instruction about which server action should be invoked and with which data, and they execute it for you. The problem just is that if they do that in a way that does not really verify the data that's arriving or the instructions that are arriving, and that's open to this vulnerability here, then any arbitrary code can be executed. That was the short summary. It's a bit more sophisticated than that. Again, I have that detailed right up here, but in the end, that is how that first attack worked, and that therefore allowed attackers to execute any kind of code on the server, because keep in mind, you could not just pass console log here, obviously, but since this is on the server, you could pass any Node.js code here to spawn any kind of process and delete files, read files, execute some complex bash scripts or whatever you want. That was the first vulnerability, and it's really, really huge, and you gotta patch your applications therefore. But now we got two new vulnerabilities that were disclosed. A denial of service vulnerability and a source code exposure vulnerability. And they again are related to server component server actions. Now you might wonder why, if this first vulnerability was patched. Well, because it seems as like during this patch process, where this of course then gets also tested, and now there's a spotlight on this problem, related attack vectors were identified. So this first vulnerability indeed doesn't exist anymore if you patched, but now it was discovered that this React flight protocol, as it's called, which is responsible for parsing and executing those instructions, has more problems that lead to these other two vulnerabilities. Now, the denial of server vulnerability in the end means that attackers could craft a request that can hit your React server component supporting server and would lead to an infinite loop. So I showed you how that first attack also involved a loop where the two chunks kept on referencing each other. Seems like you can still craft such loops and therefore have a denial of server attack, because you can spawn an infinite loop on the server that's running that React application, and that of course ultimately at some point will crash that server, which is not as bad as executing any kind of code on that server, but still not good. The other attack is the source code exposure, which could be worse than the first one, because yeah, denial of server is bad, it can crash your server, lead to a bad user experience, all that fun stuff, and it can have other serious implications too. But this one here is really bad too, because there still is a vulnerability where, again, users can craft a payload that hits your React server component endpoint, your React server action endpoint, and that is parsed such that details or your source code is exposed. Now, why is that a problem? Well, maybe not just because you don't want people to know what's going on in your code, because that per se could be a vulnerability. If people see that you're maybe not protecting against SQL injection, which you of course should, but if that becomes visible by viewing your code, that would open up a new attack vector. But that's maybe not the primary problem, though it is a problem. A bigger problem are, of course, secrets. If your source code includes a secret, a database credentials, for example, well, if people can read that source code, they can read those secrets, which could, of course, allow them to access your database or to use your AI API tokens and send requests on your behalf. Now, the problem, as they make it very clear in this article, does not persist or exist if you're using environment variables for managing those secrets. They can still view your source code, but the secrets are not exposed because those environment variables are resolved at runtime. And the source code, of course, is the source code as you wrote it, so it doesn't include those secret values. It just includes the process.env.whatever secret name. So your environment variable secrets are not exposed, but if you hard-coded secrets into your code, which you shouldn't do in the first place, but if you did it, well, then this can, of course, be bad. besides all the other reasons why this is bad. And of course, by the way, you should absolutely not hard code secrets into your source code. That was never a good idea. And well, with that exploit, it's even worse. So that is the current state. We got these two new vulnerabilities. So again, it's time to patch up. Patches have been released, at least for Next.js, as far as I know. You should patch up. But of course, you could have a bigger discussion about the implications of this. Is React too complex? Is this entire flight protocol and this idea of tightly connecting client-side and server-side code, is that maybe not the best idea? And that is definitely an interesting discussion to be had, which I will have, but where I first want to gather a bit more information and think about it. So these are the vulnerabilities, time to patch up, but yeah, let's definitely also talk about the general problems React may have related to this.